too much reliance on radio and is creating a hostile RF environment. Radio is being used where radio was not intended for everything. You know, television remotes and silly phones and iPods and all that stuff is just RF extravaganza. That's not what radio was for. That's what telephone cables are for.
Do you feel the average human is being exposed?
Too much RF.
Is that bad?
Yeah, thousands of times greater exposure than Bell Telephone ever used to allow in any of their microwave sites. Even the Navy.
For the average iPhone user right
now. You're out, when you're standing out on the street in silly phone wonderland, okay, you might as well be on the deck of an aircraft carrier being swept by search radars.
It's that bad.
That bad.
Right now.
Right now. If you look out your window and you're looking at a silly phone tower, you're getting 1,000 watts of RF right in the face, right through your front window, lighting up your whole living room. Just like there was a ship radar about, you know, 1 mile out, sweeping through your house. Except it's not pulsed, which actually makes it worse. The pulses are so short, they can't really do a lot of damage, but this is continuous wave. It's this treacherous amount of RF power. I couldn't, when I first... See, there was some guy that was getting sick from all this stuff. He was rich, and he was getting sick from this stuff in Redwood City, and he couldn't find anybody. He just paid PG&E $500,000 to put the substation feeders underground because they were giving him this horrible rheumatism. And then when they did that, $450,000 afterwards, it made it worse. So he realized that this is, you know, that was a disaster. He spent, you know, a big part of his fortune. PG told him, well, we'll just put the lines underground, and it made it worse. Well, now it was time to find somebody that really knew what was going on.
Mr. Dollar.
There's only one guy.
Where are we going to find this guy?
It took him a while, but he found me. Okay, and he was there, and the first thing he did, you know, when I met him face to face was he reached in his wallet, and he pulled out three $100 bills and handed them to me. He told me he's going to pay me $100 an hour to find out why all this stuff is making him sick. That's just after they bulldozed Camp David. And I was like, you know, insane and destitute and the whole thing and, you know, trying to juggle what cars I had around on the street. And it was really tough. So a $100 per hour job and my nice place to live in the Redwoods, which wasn't closed then, was welcome. You know, 4 hours a day, and then the rest of the day is I'm out hiking around in the Redwoods. It's great. You know, $400 in my pocket every day. And he bought all the equipment. A lot of equipment. So, you know, helped me build the station at Landers. And I could keep all the equipment. And what I learned there was flabbergasting. I could write a whole book about it. Of all the RF interference, from improperly operating AM radio stations to the 5 or 10,000 watts coming out of these cellular telephone repeaters, I never expected the power was that high. All kinds of stray power line currents. There was enough I could light a small light bulb off a ground rod. He was like in some vortex of just electromagnetic hell. See, at first I thought he was a hypochondriac, and I really didn't want to get involved with it. Because I could see his problem was his body was so out of balance, since that's what made him sensitive to all this stuff. So I did experiments to see if he was really sensitive, first to 60 cycle, you know, magnetic fields. And so, you know, I put him in I built like a big Navy degaussing coil thing, like for a minesweeper or something, out of telephone cable, and sat him in a chair in it. And then I would take, you know, the 60-cycle currents and have various magnetic fields directed, or sometimes I'd have no magnetic field. It would be turned off. And I'd, you know, ask, do you feel that? Do you feel that? Do you feel that? Do you feel that? And the guy had a remarkable sensitivity to low-frequency magnetic fields. And it was consistent with my own observations in my own body. Is it causes rheumatic pain in the bones and the joints. Because when there's a magnetic storm on the earth, I get pains in my shoulders. I know there's a magnetic storm because the pains in my shoulders.
It's caused by solar flare.
Yes, because of rheumatism. You know, by that and too much coffee. So if I had to drink the coffee, I couldn't feel the magnetic storm. So then he was complaining about the burning on his face. So, you know, I got spectrum analyzers to see what, you know, the radiation density was between, you know, like 800 megacycles and 1,200 megacycles, the silicone band. And the power level was just mind-boggling. So and that's what was burning his face. It was just, you know, radar-level RF power. You know, as soon as you open the back door, you know, it's going right through the walls of his building. He had to chicken wire the whole inside of the building and had to come up with a special ground system. And then there was something else that was making him weak all the time. So I did a whole analysis of the AM broadcast band with this guy named Bill Gabbert. And he runs all these horrible RF pollution radio and TV stations in San Francisco. So he bought one station on AM station out there in Redwood City on 1050. And then wasn't doing any band limiting or any of this stuff. And the station was like jamming out, you know, the AM band, 20 kilocycles on both sides, all the way into Los Angeles from Redwood City. So I analyzed all this with the equipment, and they were operating like a spark gap transmitter with that lousy digital, you know, hump and slap music. No filters, going into a digital modulator, and it was just putting out this spectrum of pulses, and it got into the telephone cables and power lines and was just wave-guided right through Redwood City. And it just lit his building up. It got into all the telephone cables and the conduits and the whole deal. Just lit his building up. And finally I told him, you know, the best thing you can do is either you can spend $1 million building yourself a radio frequency bunker or move.
That's
then the silly phone companies or whatever got into his employees and they started vandalizing my car and screwing with my tools and all that. So I was going to have to beat somebody's brains out. So that was the end of that. So he gave me $1,000 and let me take all my equipment down the landers. And that was a 6-month learning experience. RF pollution. Kind of right it on top of my radish seed experiments in high school. Well, let's go out to the hole.
Thank you, Mr. Dollar.